Penguin Random House Audio presents Trenton Makes by Tadzio Koelb. Read for you by Mozhan Marnò. Man is something that shall be overcome. What have you done to overcome him? Friedrich Nietzsche, thus spake Zarathustra. Part 1, 1946 to 1952.
The new guy should come too,
Jax had said in his loud voice, flat as a hand clap, his barrel chest steeped and brimming with all his endless simplicity. Of course the plan had been there all along, but in a way it was Jax who set the whole thing in motion, because Jax had said Kunstler should come to the dance hall, and Kunstler had come. It was Jax, too, who introduced Kunstler to the girl, the taxi dancer, the one called Inez Clay.
I danced with her,
Jax said, pointing out one girl after another as they swung by with their clients.
And her. I danced with her lots.
That's a lot of dimes, Jax. It's like you've danced with every girl in Trenton. No wonder you roll your own. Kunstler's little metallic rasp of a voice was hard to make out over the music, so Jax had to bend to hear him ask, What about that one?
Oh, that girl? Yeah, I danced with her. The guys say she's got trouble. Kind of like a dipso, they said.
Kunstler lit a cigarette and said,
Like a thing is a thing.
What?
Like a thing is a thing. Someone like a thief is a thief. Someone like a cut-up is a cut-up. And somebody like a dipso is definitely a dipso. Like just is. There's no difference. Yeah, well, she don't go bitching around or anything, I don't think. She just drinks a bit is all.
He lowered his voice and said, Actually, the other girls sometimes say that she's kiki because they figure maybe she don't like men on account of she doesn't like it when the guys get too, touchy, you know.
Oh, touchy. Sure, I know,
said Kunstler, who instead didn't touch her, or at least not at first, except to shake her hand when Jax introduced them, calling her Miss Clay, and later to put a hand on a place high on her back when they danced. Instead, he bought her drinks and gave her tickets, which she would rip, turning away to tuck half in the top of her stocking, passing the other half seemingly without looking to a ticket taker, who simply appeared and vanished so quickly again into the crowd that he was little more ever than a reaching hand and a gesture, as if the beaver board walls with their red, white, and blue bunting had arms. Then, during the band's breaks, Kunstler bought her a fresh drink every time, and while she drank it, they talked. About what, the others couldn't imagine, but she laughed a lot, and when she danced with other clients, it seemed that she and Abe Kunstler still found each other's eyes. The girl was small. That's what caught Kunstler's attention. He wouldn't dance with a tall woman, wouldn't be the little guy with his face buried in some bosom to be laughed at. So the sight of her, petite but not boyish, filling her rayon dress, was a relief. He watched her smile at a factory man, still in his cheap wartime woolens, and then draw him to the crowded floor, let him stand too close and reach gradually down her back. He also noted the almost invisible retreat by which she baffled his hands when the song was done. No refusal, but an evaporation that was also a barrier. She was watery, effortlessly variable, not to be grabbed with fingers. Their first time on the dance floor, Kunstler had offered her his right hand, and she laughed. He pulled it away. Don't be angry, she said. He nodded.
Mind if we stand?
He started, and she waited, and then nodded and whispered, Away from your friends? Sure. She led him a little way across the hall. Now watch, she demonstrated, moving around him as if he were a spindle. Operating his arms. Open position here, and now closed position, see? This is how to move for an arm lead, and this is how you move for a body lead.
Oh, fine, he said. I won't remember that.
Don't worry. The names don't mean anything. It's what you do that matters. You'll get it. It's no big deal. This one's not too fast. It will be easy. she said as they started to move away towards the floor. Even then, Kunstler was aware how good they looked together, that her softness suited his sharp bones. The girl Inez said, "A few more kisses." Abe pulled his head back and said, "Sorry, what?" "The song, A Few More Kisses. I like it, don't you like it?" "Sure," he said. "It's swell." But he was concentrating hard on the raised left arm and his right hand at her back. The mirror image, the inverted world, and then they were done. And when her body was gone, he was left with a sense he couldn't quite name. At the end of the night, Kunstler waited, ready to help the girl when she stumbled a little drunkenly on the stairs outside the entrance. She asked if he would stop with her in a bar. "The booze at the hall is watered, you know. And I want to listen to some real music. That band's terrible. Everything in that place is terrible. Don't you just love music? I mean, real music, good music. Not that stuff they play there." He bought her a gin and Italian and watched her carry the short brimming glass cautiously to a booth where she sat without her shoes and sculpting her arches with both hands, saying, "You're never off the clock in those dumps. If you want to even think, you better goddamn hop it. They run you sore. You know when we haven't got a fellow, we're supposed to dance with each other? Like I'd spend a minute longer with one of those girls than I have to." They sat quietly for a minute, Kunstler neither moving nor speaking, just watching her through the bar darkness with his cast iron expression. Inez finally said, "Hey, I noticed you work with mostly a lot of mix. Are you a Catholic?" "What, me? Oh, hell, I don't know. Maybe. I'm not what I am anymore, whatever it is."
"Not a church person, you mean?"
"Me neither." She nodded at that and took a drink before nodding again, as if her head rested on the ocean, and said, "I'm Episcopalian. I guess I mean that my mother was." Then she spoke almost unstoppably, a surge of memories about foster homes, where she experienced some things too soon and in overabundance, and others not enough. The girl had been 15 when she accepted her first ticket to dance with a boyish enlisted man at one of the halls near Mountain Home. Both of them had been careful and shy. Back then, she drank only Coke and bitters, but of course it was a dance hall, and really, they sold two things. The one was illusion, the make-believe of intimacy and gaiety and carelessness. The other was alcohol, which dressed the stage where the illusion could perform. "The pop hurt my stomach after a while," she told him. "Can you believe it, that I had my first cocktail for my health? I always crossed my ankles back then, too. Well, hey, that's life. I mean, what are you gonna do?" It was in Mountain Home that she met the young, brill-creamed piano player she had followed east. "He was called Boat," the girl said, "on account of he had huge feet, really big, I mean it. He could hardly find anything to fit them. This drummer once said Boat was wrong. He could buy any old shoes, and it didn't matter what size, just to wear the box they come in." "Isn't that funny?" she asked without laughing. She also described the girl singer they had met at a show in the taxi hall at Millville, a girl whose stockings weren't full of blisters, a girl Boat finally left with, taking with him all the money from the motel room, including all the hard-won nickels that were her 50% share of the dimes men paid to dance. "It was mine as much as his, you know. I had to start again, and I'll tell you, it's not easy to save up money at 5 cents a dance. Someone saw them get in a cab. That's all. That's how I knew they were gone." She looked up at Kunstler and, leaning against him, asked, "Do you think it's because I like spooning more than I like the other stuff? It's not that I don't want to be more like that, more like what it was he hoped for, more what I suppose all men hope for. But things are what they are, I guess. Ever have too much ice cream when you were a kid? A man who was friends with my mother, it was like that with him. The worst part was he made me call him Uncle Andrew." When at last she relaxed into her gin haze and was quiet, Kunstler led her gently to his rooming house, where he checked that the landlord wasn't awake to see him taking her up the stairs. Jax had said to them, "The new guy should come too." And at just that moment, everyone, even the ones who might have wanted to argue with him, realized Kunstler was standing right there, the first dressed as usual, silent but at hand, one eye closed against the smoke of his cigarette. Loitering, they called it. He stood with his tie knotted tight.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.